This feeling that you've completed a piece and are able to play it fluently from beginning to the end gives you such a great sense of achievement, especially because usually it takes a while to get there. But there may be times when you've been putting a lot of work into getting to know a few different pieces and you know them all kind of wellish, but time is passing by and you still can't really say that any of them are complete. I'm Zuzanna, I'm a harpist and a harp teacher, and I know how much time and effort it takes to complete even a simple piece. If you've been feeling stuck for a while, today I've got for you 8 tips that will help you get your pieces done. When you learn to play the harp on your own, it can be tricky to manage both the day-to-day practice and at the same time to be in charge of your long-term progress all on your own. There are so many lovely pieces out there, and I heard quite a few learners say that they easily get distracted by the next shiny thing and then end up having too many pieces to take care of at once. So the first step is to choose one, just one piece that you want to complete. I know it can be hard to make that decision and that it's very tempting to try to do more, but completing a piece does call for some rather intense work. And if you're already working on many pieces, chances are that picking more than one will make it all too challenging. So I suggest that you start and make a commitment to just one piece, but do everything you can to get it done. Today I will give you some ideas to help you decide on your plan of action and to keep that commitment. One of the best things you can do to hold yourself accountable is to write these things down, and in the description of this video you will find a link to download a simple checklist that can help you come up with a plan and stick to it. So make sure you print it out, fill it in, and keep near your music stand in your day-to-day practice. After you've chosen your one piece, I'd like you to think of how can you create the most supportive environment for working towards your goal. Telling others about your commitment can work really well. It doesn't even have to be someone who plays the harp, it can be someone from your family or a friend. You can simply tell them the title of your chosen piece and say, "This will be my priority for the next few weeks and months." For some extra support, you can consider finding a practice buddy, maybe someone who also wants to complete a piece. That could be either another harpist or any other musician. If they are at the similar level to yours, that's great, but it's not necessary, and you don't even have to know them beforehand. You can simply go online and post a short note in one of the many harp groups out there. In the description below, I'll put a link to mine. Once you get a reply, you can agree with them to exchange a short message every week to see how it's going for you and for them. It doesn't have to be anything terribly serious, but it can really help your motivation if you know that you told them about your plan for the week and that in a few days from now they'll expect to hear how it went. While we're at it, I'd like to talk for a moment about setting timeframes, or the dreadful word, deadlines. Remember, these are not for you to beat yourself up if you don't make it by then. Instead, I'd like to encourage you to make a list of things that you can do to help yourself achieve your goal, even if you're late. Bear in mind that sometimes it's not easy to tell how long completing a piece may take. Even teachers happen to get it wrong and under or overestimate how much time a student would need to work on a piece. So when you're thinking about deciding on, let's call it, a completion date, think of ways in which this could serve you. For example, you could share your intention with the people that you told about your goal and perhaps ask them to listen to you playing the piece on your chosen date, at whatever stage your piece will be. Or you could say something like, "If I don't complete this piece by then, I will get in touch with this harp teacher." You can even contact them before and put a date in the diary already, and if a piece is complete, you can just play it to them. I'll tell you more about benefits of playing to others later in the video, and if it isn't ready, you will have someone there to give you support so you can reach your goal. Once you know the one piece that you're going to focus on and you have put your support systems in place, I'd like you to look at any tricky spots that may be still causing some trouble within your piece. It could be that you know your whole piece really well, but there may still be a few annoying spots that are really holding you back from being able to say that it's done. You probably have a good feel of what they are, roughly, but being really precise about where they are is really going to make a difference and help you achieve your goal. So look at any sections where perhaps mistakes happen more often, or that give you some sort of anxious feelings as you approach them, and then write down the bar numbers or mark these sections in your score. If you're a fan of sticky tabs like me, you can use them to mark your music, and as you fix your tricky spots, you can then remove the tabs and enjoy seeing your progress in this really visual way right in front of you. Now, once you know exactly where your tricky spots are, start with deciding on maximum 3 that are the most difficult and most urgent to tackle. Try to be as precise as possible, not only about the location, but also about what's really tricky in there. If your chosen section is very long, more than a few bars, it may be that you're facing quite a few challenges in there, and then it may be useful to divide it in smaller sections and focus on one thing at a time. Now, the reason why I asked you to pick these tricky spots is that completing a piece is a rather big goal, and it can feel really overwhelming if you don't know where to start. So what you want is to have a very clear idea of what you're going to work on when you sit down at the harp. This is really important if you happen to have less time for practice on some days, or if some of your practice sessions happen to be cut short. If you know your tricky spots and you make sure you start your practice from there, you will make sure that even if you only have 5 minutes to play, you've managed to move this work forward, towards completing a piece. With one of my students, actually now a former student, we came up with a really nice idea, and that's actually one that you can use anytime in your practice, regardless at what stage your pieces are. One of the things me and my student had in common was our love for tea. If you're watching this, hello. And with the weather here in the UK, where we live, on some days you just can't help but have quite a few cups as you go on with your day. So I knew that my student was used to putting a kettle on at least a few times a day, and this gave us this idea of the kettle boil routine, which is a section of a piece that you can play while your kettle is boiling. And then every week during our lesson we would decide what was the one spot that would require some extra attention that she could then practice whenever she was waiting for the water for the tea to boil. Now, I understand if you're not a massive tea lover, but this could be a section of a piece that you can play whenever you find yourself in the same room as the harp, or whenever you walk past. In fact, it doesn't even have to be connected to any other activity, but what's important is to be really clear what's your point of focus at any given time, and to have a go at it whenever you have a minute or two. The next step works best when you're at the stage where all your tricky spots are nicely coming along, or brewing nicely. Now, you are going to find one speed at which you can play your whole piece through. It doesn't matter how slow it is, but it needs to work for your whole piece, including all your tricky spots, which is why it's best to do it when they are already progressing well. For this stage, metronome practice is just the best way to go, and I cannot recommend it highly enough. If that's something new to you, make sure you check out my previous episodes where you can hear more about how to make the most of this kind of practice. I'll put some links for you in the description of this video. Playing with the metronome shows you really clearly which sections need some more attention. And even if there are large parts of your piece that you can play really well and up to speed, do slow them down so they match those other beats. If you are working towards completing a piece and being able to play all of it up to speed, at this stage there's no benefit in having all your different beats at various speeds. After all, you want them all to come together at the end. It's like serving an elaborate meal where different beats are cooking separately, and then you want to serve them hot all together. If some are almost ready, you need to turn the temperature down and wait until the rest is well cooked, so your guests can enjoy a nice meal without any burnt beets. So trust me and put your metronome on, and then find one speed that works for your whole piece, and then see if you can play it all through. Let me know how it goes. Now that you're using slow practice to work on being able to play your piece through, it is a good moment to make another important decision. Are you going to play this piece with music or from memory? Both ways are equally good, and it's only up to you and what you feel most comfortable with. But it's important to have clarity here. What happens very often is that we likely memorize some sections of a piece, even without trying. And even though you've still got a score in front of you, you're not really looking at it anymore. But you may not be quite aware of it, and you may not be very clear about where you start looking away and when you need to go back to the music. While this is mostly fine when you're practicing and still working on smaller sections, when you're playing a piece through, and especially if you've got someone listening, or when you're trying to record it, your nerves can upset this delicate balance. When that happens, you can find yourself stopping in the middle of a piece, looking at the score, unable to recognize any notes there, and not remembering even what your fingers just did or were about to do next. It's like a rabbit caught in the headlights, and it's not a very nice place to be. So check in with yourself. How do you feel about playing this piece with music or from memory? Which will make you feel more at ease? And I know that some people only consider a piece finished when they can play it from memory, but I believe there is no right or wrong here. If you want to know more, you can hear me talking about this in some of the earlier episodes, but for now, I believe that what matters most is you making the decision and going for the solution that makes you feel at your best. And then you either make sure that you can follow the music while you play and know exactly where you are in the score, or that you've got very clear mental cues and a solid support system for your memory. If you want to learn more about that, I'll put some links for you in the description of this video. Working towards finishing a piece and following all these steps can get quite intense. So the next tip I'd like to give you here is to pay attention to how you're feeling and to be aware of tiredness or any difficult emotions that come up. Sometimes when we work really, really hard towards a big goal like this and we try to stay motivated for a long time, we can just get tired. So make sure that while you are still very clear on your intention, you don't end up pushing yourself too hard and getting fed up of this piece. I recommend to take one day off a week so you get an opportunity to take a break and come back with a fresh mind and new energy. Before I give you my last tip, I'm curious to hear from you. Have you experienced feeling stuck and not being able to complete a piece? And if so, what would you do differently? Feel free to let us know and share your plans in the comments. The final tip that I've got for you today is all about playing for others. Playing for others is not only an opportunity for your pieces to mature, but also an amazing motivation that can help you keep going through difficult times. If you've decided to commit to some sort of a time frame, asking someone to listen to you around your chosen date is such a good idea. Another thing you can do is work on recording yourself playing the piece and then promise that you will send some videos to your practice buddy, the practice buddy that we talked about in tip number 2. Having someone listening to you can help in so many different ways, and even more if you can do it a couple of times. First, there's the motivation, and then there's also this funny thing that when you play for someone and the mistake comes up, it's usually something that's never happened before when you were practicing on your own. If you can record yourself playing and listen back, this can help you narrow down these few spots that you can improve to make your piece even better. The bottom line is that making a recording or playing for someone is not supposed to be this huge thing that will stress you out, but rather something that will help you make progress and that you may perhaps even enjoy doing. Think of it like a snapshot of the moment where you are in your journey with the harp. Even when you're ready to say that a piece is complete, every time you play it, it will sound different. And that's where the beauty is. If you found this episode helpful, leave a like and do let me know in the comments. Also, make sure to subscribe Coffee Break Harp for more tips on playing the harp. I will see you here very soon. Take care for now. Bye!